Howard Ward is chief investment officer. He's also portfolio manager at GAMCO. He helps to oversee more than $35 billion. Howard, glad to have you with us this morning. Before we talk about what you expect to hear and what you hope you don't hear from Ben Bernanke later this week, I want to ask you what you've been doing, quite simply, in all this volatility. We saw those four straight weeks of sell-off. Where did you pick up good buys?
Well, we're always looking for opportunities to rearrange our portfolio a little bit. I tend to be drawn during periods like this where there's a real decline in all stock prices. Very few stocks did not participate in this decline. I tend to be drawn to the bargains, the stocks that have been hurt the most during this decline. And the stocks that have come down the most would tend to be those that have been more exposed to the economy. So industrial names, energy names, technology names. I think those areas in particular offer very good values right now.
And what about the ones, the brands that maybe you feel like you should be holding more of? I'm thinking of, I don't know, an Apple, for example. Is this one of note that you feel like, okay, it took a pretty big hit, but I still like the fundamentals?
Apple is our largest holding on the growth side at GAMCO, and we think the fundamentals there are extremely strong. And this is a company that stock is now selling at about 11 times forward 12-month earnings, which really is quite cheap.
Now, no matter how cheap certain stocks get, certain groups get, you might not be interested. Financials seems to be one of them. You feel like they have further to fall before you would consider buying?
Well, a couple of issues here. One is the financials, as we know, face real regulatory headwinds. A lot of the rules for Dodd-Frank haven't even been written yet, and we're waiting for regulators to do that.
Something like 38 out of 238 have been written, so
And another issue is if you're in the business of selling loans, and a lot of these financials are, in an environment where loan demand is anemic, it's tough to grow. And so there's a growth challenge there. But finally, you know, back in the 1980s, these banks sold at very low valuations. They typically sold at 6 or 7 times earnings with dividend yields of 4 to 5%. We could be sort of.
And that was the norm.
Was the norm. I mean, we could really be seeing a bit of a normalization of bank valuations going back to a period pre sort of go-go 90s when this was a very acceptable, very normal valuation level for a lot of banks. And so I'm sure there are banks out there that are exceptional values right now, but I don't think on an industry-wide basis that you can make the claim that these are screaming buys.
Speaking of screaming buys, screaming sells as well, there's a lot more volatility in the market. Some people that we've reached out to say this is because of high-frequency trades. This is because of larger and larger blocks being pushed through at milliseconds. Does this actually make for more opportunities for companies such as GAMCO where you are long-term investors? In other words, you can profit from this volatility, as you mentioned, with Apple by picking up names you want to own anyway, and you get them cheaper.
Well, I think you can make that argument that for some very sophisticated investors, they can take advantage of the volatility, and therefore it's all well and good. But I think the actual impact on the market is more serious and more negative than that. The volatility has been so breathtaking of late, and as we know, 70% or 80% of the volume has been from high-frequency trading, that this level of volatility is scaring people away from stocks. Now, I've been in this business since 1978. It scares me to see the market go down 645 points.
So you think the average investor says, you know what, forget it, I can't stomach this, I'll put my money in cash, I'll put my money in bonds, and that way I don't have to have a heart attack every time I look
exactly
at the newspaper.
And that's exactly what happened. 2 weeks ago, $30 billion left equity mutual funds. And it's because of that volatility. Volatility that week wasn't all that bad. Net for the week, the S&P was down 1.7%, but $30 billion left the market.
Yeah, that's a huge amount. That said, fright included, you say Ben Bernanke should say absolutely nothing and do absolutely nothing with QE3, at least on Friday.
Yeah, I don't think he has enough information to make a good decision at this point. And I think he knows that. I do think he feels some pressure from the stock market's decline to respond in some fashion. And I think he'll lay out perhaps a game plan for what he wants to do should the economic data warrant him doing something later on. I think maybe he'll come out and say, we're going to extend the maturities on our existing book of bonds without enlarging our balance sheet. That might be a first step. And then I think at a second step, at a later date, he's going to try to focus on maybe capping the 10-year treasury at something like 2%, which is near where it is right now. But that's not for now. He can't respond. There isn't enough information to work with yet. I don't think he wants to jump the gun and look desperate. I think he needs to wean the market off this Bernanke put expectation. The market's give the market its manhood back. Yeah. It's been stripped of its manhood in recent years with all this Fed. Every time it rolls over, the Fed gives it something. The market can stand on its own. The economy is not that bad. So I think that you just have to give this some time to work.
What about 9% unemployment? I mean, there are elements of the economy that are, when we talk about fear in the markets, the reason that fear is there is because there are concerns about U.S. growth. But you're still saying these data points are not enough to point conclusively to this idea that we could need more help.
Yeah, I mean, we're still adding jobs. You know, payrolls in July were better than expected. And in fact, before the seasonal adjustment, it was 255,000 jobs. 2 weeks ago, we had the lowest weekly unemployment number since April. And so, the news is not all bad. People focus on the Philly Fed. The Philly Fed number of last week was a weak number. The correlation of the Philly Fed to the ISM, 0.08, which is one way of saying it's not correlated at all. Don't read too much into that number. Right. So let's see how this next batch of data looks. There's not enough news coming out this week, I think, that's going to make Bernanke move one way or the other. I think he would be doing himself a favor to be very restrained in whatever he says in Jackson Hole on Friday.
We'll see what he does, Howard. Thank you very much for the good conversation. In the meantime, Howard Ward joining us there, CIO and portfolio manager at GAMCO Investors.